The next thing that we're going to do is actually open our hearts and open our minds to receive the offering song. This is a new thing that we're doing within our program. We're always trying to improve the type of experience that we gain. So I'd like everybody to open their hearts and receive the offering song here that we're going to play right before our upcoming sermon.
Age to age, he stands.
Thank you, everybody, for being open to a new activity. I think as you read the lyrics, this actually really introduces our upcoming program and upcoming content that Pastor Mike's going to deliver really perfectly. I asked Mike a couple days ago, you know, what will you be speaking about on Sunday? And he said, you know, Clara, have you ever wanted to do something in your life that you're like, that would be great, but maybe I'm not there yet, right? Or everybody has aspirations or goals on a daily or a weekly basis, but they kind of like, you know, fly by. And sometimes we forget to enroll God in our goals and our intentions for the week. And Pastor Mike today is going to share some recent experiences that he's had where he had these nice-to-haves or these goals, and he was able to enroll God and achieve a lot of success. So let's all welcome up Pastor Mike right now for our main service today.
Thank you, Clara. She's such a great MC. I love it. So I chose the song, How Great Is Our God. I know that there are certain elements of it that we don't necessarily relate to all the points in our faith, but there's, you know, just the part of just recognizing how wonderful God is and how great God is really stuck out to me this past week. I wanted to share a couple situations that have happened in the last few months that just really highlighted this point to me of that God is alive and working in our lives, even sometimes we don't feel like it, or even sometimes we don't notice it. First of all, a number of months ago, I got really inspired about upgrading our video equipment. And hang with me here, this story has a meaning. But I thought, you know, we had a little camera over here that was always running out of batteries and the quality wasn't very good. So I thought, hey, let's increase our professionalism, and maybe we can even get to the point where someday we're even live streaming our content to other people around the country, people who maybe they don't feel so inspired about the message they hear in their own church, or maybe they live kind of remote, but then they would be inspired to hear what we have. So it's been a process. But at that time, I brought it to our council, and there wasn't a unanimous support. And so I decided to drop the idea and just, you know, I just felt, hey, maybe this isn't the right time. Maybe we'll do it again someday in the future. Maybe we're just not ready for this. And so maybe a month went by, and, you know, the minutes from that meeting went out. And then one day, I was kind of reflecting on it. I was like, oh, yeah, it's kind of a bummer that it couldn't work out. But it's okay. It's okay. I just let it go. And then this letter arrives in the mail, and I open it up, and it's to my surprise, it was a check for $1,300. And there was a note that said, you know, I saw that, you know, you wanted to do this project, and it didn't get a lot of support, so please use this money for this project. And I was like, wow, that's kind of like just, it was a real shock for me because just so unexpected. I had another experience just recently, a couple weeks ago, where I've been talking with some people, mostly between me and Adonia and some others, about the idea of getting an assistant. We thought, you know, there's just a certain number of things that we want to do. We want to invest more in our social media. We want to be sending more articles to headquarters. There's just certain things that we're just not getting done. They're falling through the cracks because we just don't have the time and the energy for them. And I thought, you know, it'd be really great to have someone who could kind of take over the video editing and things like that. But when I thought about it, I'm like, who would want to do those things, you know? Surely we'd have to pay somebody, but, you know, I didn't really feel like we necessarily had the cash flow to pay another, like, an employee to do this kind of a part-time work. And then, you know, we thought about the idea, well, maybe they could live with us, and then we could kind of trade room and board. But I thought, well, we don't have any space. You know, how would that work? We already have somebody living with us. And we just, you know, we had thought about it, and we thought of how great an idea it would be, but then we couldn't really see a way to actually fulfill the idea, so we just were, I don't know, just kind of like, it kind of just dragged on. And then about 4 or 5 days ago, maybe a week ago, I got a message from an old student of ours back when I was working at the Blessed Teens Academy. And she's been living in Korea for the last 3 years. And she is wanting to come to America and take a break for 6 months and help out with the church and maybe do some self-development and, you know, and just kind of have a little bit of a break. And she said, I have some experience doing videos, and you know, I can do this and that. And I was like, you know what? You know, this actually could work out really well. Why don't you, we'll find a space for you. You can live with us. We'll give you room and board, and you can help out with these things for the church. And then we just call it a fair deal. And you know, she was planning to stay in Korea for longer and work to make money so that she could come to Colorado and not be like a moocher. But I said, you know, why don't you just come, because we could really use your help. And and she said, yeah, that sounds like a fair deal to me. So she's coming next month, and I'm just, these kind of experiences have been happening over and over again, and we just feel like we haven't even advertised this idea to anybody, but we felt like God knew what we were looking for, and he found a way to help provide whatever those things were. And I mean, I felt like these are, must be somewhat insignificant to God, you know, like, does God really care about us wanting an assistant? Does God really care about us getting better video equipment? And I thought, well, maybe, maybe so. But it just, it was just surprising to us to see this kind of thing happen over and over again, where we have an idea or an inspiration, just somehow, it just pops out of nowhere almost sometimes. It just happens. Not always, but it does. And it's kind of nice to have those experiences. Obviously, that's not the point of my sermon today, but it's really wonderful to be able to have those experiences where we feel like God is looking out for our needs and looking out for the things that are, you know, important to us and looking for ways to provide those things. But of course, we know that that's not the only way that God works in our lives. We know that God, you know, likes to give us the things that we want, you know, at times, but also that sometimes God gives us things that we're not expecting, or God gives us things that we actually don't really like very much. Let's see here. There's a quote in the Bible. It says, "If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that?" It's from Matthew. And our founder, Reverend Moon, he says, "I warn you not to be overjoyed when happiness comes to you. And don't try to escape when misery and heartbreak come. All of it is for you. Please be aware of the fact that you are responsible for everything that comes to you. And if you meet with it and win over it and conquer it, you are going to be the victor. You will at least learn a lesson from the experience. You are responsible for the occasion, and if you are victorious over the difficulty, you must be able to pass it on to others, and you must be able to link it to your goal." So we recognize that in life, sometimes we get what we want and sometimes we don't. And sometimes what comes along in our life are really difficult, challenging, heartbreaking experiences. And sometimes we don't know how to digest them, and sometimes we don't know how to look at them with gratitude, and we don't know how to look at them in a way that, how in the world could God use this experience, or how in the world could God be related with this experience? And I kind of feel like sometimes I'm like a child before God. I'm really grateful when God gives me experiences that I really like, and I'm really grateful when God does things that I want. But when I have a really difficult experience, a person that I can't get along with, or something financially bad happens, or whatever, something, maybe you could think of something in your life that you're not very happy with, then it's easy for me to be upset at God, or at the very least just have a complaining and frustrated heart. Maybe I don't say, "God, I can't believe you did this," or "I can't believe you allowed this to happen in my life," or "I resent you." Maybe we don't necessarily say that. But maybe in our hearts, we're just angry and frustrated that, you know, maybe we feel like I'm doing everything right. Why are difficult things happening in my life? I kind of feel like that's the mentality of a child. I feel like that's, when I feel that way, I look back on myself and I realize it's kind of a child's mentality because, and I have children, so I know. When you give her some candy, she thinks, oh, mommy and daddy love me. But if you try to get her to go to bed at night, at like 10 o'clock at night or whatever, it's supposedly so unreasonable. And she feels like, oh, mommy and daddy don't love me. They're not letting me have the things that I want, letting me do things the way that I want to do things. And this is kind of the heart of the child, actually. We were happy when God gives us something that we really like and that seems to kind of fit along with the things that we want and need. But then when we come across a difficult experience in life, then we question, you know, is God really working in my life? Am I really doing the right thing? You know, why is this happening to me? And I think that's natural, I mean, to a certain degree, right? Because we don't live and breathe with God. We don't know why he's doing what he's doing. But I believe that if we believe that there is a God, and that we believe in the God that we believe in, that God is actually involved in my life and cares about my life, and I have a responsibility, then we have to recognize that there must be more to it than that. I want to share another quote. This is from Reverend Moon's autobiography. The most important team, a person on the team, is the manager, who watches over the entire team from the sidelines. The manager doesn't run or score goals, but his power is greater than all the other players put together. Similar to a manager who sees things that the players cannot see and gives signals, God sees things that we cannot see and gives us signs. If the players follow the manager's signs well, they will almost always win. But if the manager sends signs and foolish players either don't understand them or ignore them and play according to their own thinking, the team can only lose. I just thought, wow, this is such a powerful statement, actually. Because what he's saying is that God is always sending us signs. It may not be the signs that we're looking for, but maybe God is trying to tell us, you got to get out of that job. You got to get out of that rut in your life. You got to get out of that relationship, or something. And he's sending us some kind of sign, but maybe it's not, maybe we're just sitting there being like, why is my life difficult, you know? And not being able to recognize that maybe God's trying to speak to us and tell us something that we need to hear. I could really relate with this at some point. It's happened several times over the years, the last few years. But at one point, I remember really vividly, I had a prayer, and it felt really, like, meaningful. And I had tears in my eyes, and I was telling God, I was looking at the situation in our movement all around the country, our churches, our young people in our movement, and I was feeling like there are so many members of our church who are struggling so much. They're struggling, they're suffering, and they want to believe in the value of what we have, but it's so hard to see it manifested before their eyes, and they want to be able to believe in it, and I don't know, it was just so many things running through my mind. I have a hard time expressing it now, but I just felt like, I told God at that moment, I said, God, bring those people. Me and Adonia, but it was my prayer, you know, I will take care of them. And now, that sounds kind of nice, like that sounds kind of sincere, right? But actually, if you think back on it, it's a kind of a really silly thing. I almost feel kind of funny for asking such a thing to God. I felt like the heart was good, but at the same time, like, really? Like, do we even have the capacity to do such a thing? Like, with what we have now, could we even really, like, conceive of taking in such a group of people with all the baggage that may come with it, and the struggles and the concepts and the heartache that so many people have gone through, and really be able to take that and grow a thriving, prospering community? Or would we just drown from it? And I thought to myself, you have to be careful with what you ask for, because kind of along with that prayer comes a kind of a, I'm sure God is looking at that and saying, well, that sounds like a really nice idea, but you know, you're going to have to really grow. You're really going to have to be able to expand as leaders to really be able to, I mean, if you really want to do what you say you want to do, you have to expand your ability to love and your ability to allow people to be owners of what they're doing, and many, many, many different things that come with trying to lead a community that, you know, we struggle just to take care of our, you know, smallish community. How can we think to be able to do something bigger? And so I recognized later on that when I was going through some difficulties that I have to really be careful, because I prayed for something, and if God is going to provide that for us, then that means that we're going to have to really be able to expand our hearts and our minds. And that's probably going to mean we're going to have to go through some difficulties. That's going to mean we're going to have to go through some challenging experiences, and we're going to have to be grateful for those experiences. I had another quote that I didn't include, but one of the things that I love about our faith and our teaching is this concept of and this lifestyle that our true parents have lived, that all comes down to gratitude, and especially gratitude in the face of situations that we could easily be so resentful for or ungrateful for. I love how our founders have lived that life. They've lived gratitude in the most difficult kind of circumstances, the most unjust circumstances, in the prison camps and everything. And there was a quote that I had, and it kind of talked about, I'm sorry I don't have it, but it talked about how important it is to be grateful, and that when we complain, when we feel bitter about experiences because we don't understand why we're having them, then we lose that opportunity to receive the blessing that God might have for us through that experience. So, for myself, I recognize that when a difficult experience comes my way, I have to remember to be very grateful. But I also recognize that it's not enough to just be grateful. It's not enough to just say, oh, I need to be, I know, you know, it's not enough to just intellectually understand that we should be grateful in difficult situations, that we should be grateful when it doesn't feel natural to be grateful. But we need to get to the place where we feel to our bones grateful, thank you, God, and with tears, that you could love me through this experience, that God could love us through that difficult experience, even if it doesn't feel like it. And I had this experience recently, and I just felt, it was really strange because I was going through a difficult experience. I can't get into it, but I was really frustrated. And then, I don't know, something just switched in me, and the song came on, the song, How Great Is Our God, and I just started to think about the prayer that I had, where I wanted to bring together the families, and I wanted to bring together the young people in our movement and create something new and something better. And I just recognized, actually, this is God's love. This is God's love for me. This is God's love for our community. And it may not look like it, but these difficult experiences that we go through, this difficult experience that I was going through, in that moment, I could feel like this was God's love for me. Because through this experience, I was going to grow to be a better, bigger person. And that's what I really could resonate in this last part of that quote, where he says, you must be able to pass it on to others, and you must be able to link it to your goal. All of us, we have an idea of what we want to, I have an idea of what I want to accomplish in my life. And in the moment where I could recognize that this experience was actually a part of me reaching that goal, then I could really feel like God is really looking out for us. it just wasn't in the way that I was expecting. And it really wasn't in the way that I wanted. Actually, I really, really been happy not to go through that experience. It would have been really nice. But I feel really liberated afterwards. And I could really repent. And I could really repent for my complainingness and my lack of perspective and lack of not seeing how God is trying to work in my life, even though I asked him to. And so it was a very healthy moment for me, and I'm just so grateful. I wanted to be able to share that with you because I felt like, I mean, is there anybody in this room that doesn't go through those kind of experiences sometimes? Everybody. We all do. But we're also people who believe in God. We're people who believe in faith. We're people who believe that God has a purpose and is trying to accomplish something. And he wants us to be a part of that. So naturally, God is trying to work in our lives. But the degree that he's able to do that and the degree that he's able to actually touch us and the degree that we allow him to through these experiences, it really is up to us. It's up to how much gratitude we can have, how much perspective we can have to see that even difficult circumstances, there might be something God is trying to show us. Maybe not, I don't know, but you know, maybe he is. But at the very least, we can learn lessons, we can learn experiences, we can become bigger people. And God, and I believe God will use that. We just maybe not don't know how. And maybe God wants us, not maybe, maybe we go through things in life and they're unavoidable, but maybe God has a vision for our life. Maybe we're meant to help people who have gone through difficult things that we've gone through. Never know. But surely there are people who need help, who need guidance and trying to get through different things in life. And we can be the people to help those people. But we can't do it if we look at our experiences with bitterness and anger and we resent those experiences. We can only do it if we can overcome them and we feel the gratitude and the love from God that comes from overcoming those experiences. So thank you so much. I have one more point. It's not necessarily related to this message, but that is the thing I wanted to share. But we are revamping a few things for service starting in September once everyone comes back from summer travels and camping and all that stuff. One of the things that I'm doing, I just got inspired to do it. It doesn't really go beyond that, but I recently was reading this book, The Purpose-Driven Church. And it was written actually maybe 20 or 30 years ago by Rick Warren. He's a very famous Christian pastor, but he actually spent some time studying our movement back in the day. And he really goes into what it takes to not just grow a church. If you read this book, you recognize it's really not about growing a church, but he really goes into how do you nurture a community? How do you take care of people? How do you bring people from the point where they're not really sure what they believe and they don't necessarily have a lot of passion or commitment to the point where they are your right-hand person? Things like that. How do you address the needs of a community? And he talks about how do you deal with a community that's stagnant and struggling and many, many different things like that. And I've read it twice, but I never finished it. And but there was many times where as I was reading it, I thought, there's so many things in here that I want to be able to share with brothers and sisters, but like to try to do it in a sermon is, I've implemented a few points, but it's very, very difficult, and there's so many points to bring up. So what I'm actually going to start doing is in September, I'm going to start reading one section every day, and I'm going to record a small video, and it's going to be 5, max 10 minutes long. And I'm just going to share a little bit about what that was that I read, and why I feel like it's relevant to our movement and where we are now. How can we implement that to, even though it's a Christian book and everything, and even though there's certain things about it that necessarily aren't, you know, in line with what we teach and what we believe, but there are so many things there that are just, they're very true. And I hope through that, and this is obviously very voluntary, it's not gonna go out in the regular emails. But my hope through that is that we all can get on the same page about what we're trying to accomplish here and what needs to happen in our community, not just here in Colorado, but in the greater movement worldwide and nationwide to really bring a kind of a revival and a new spirit. And so I personally feel really powerful about it. I don't know who would want to be a part of it, but I am going to have my own little email list, and I'm also going to be doing it with a number of other pastors, young pastors around the country. And so if you would like to be a part of this list, you know, please let me know, and I would love to add you to it. And like I said, it's going to be a short 10-minute thing. It won't take a lot out of your day. But I believe that if enough of us do this, then we will be working together to accomplish a vision instead of me and Adonia trying to share a vision that maybe everybody's not feeling inspired about. So I just want to share that with you and to thank you so much for being here and listening to the message today. I just want to remind you again that God might be working in your life in ways that you may not recognize, but if you have ever prayed to God to give you a bigger heart or to accomplish a certain thing, then please recognize that God is loving us not just through the nice experiences that we have where we really feel like, oh, God loves me, but also through these difficult experiences too. And thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Pastor Mike. For me personally, I was so moved by how real you were, how honest you were. Thank you for sharing so deeply. We are so lucky to have such a loving and innovative and open pastor who wants to improve our services for many weeks to come. So if you have any ideas or any suggestions, please feel free to talk to us. We want to make sure to deliver the best experience to you every Sunday. All right. So at this time, we are going to be having the offering basket walk down the middle aisle. So if you'd like to give your offering and put your faith into action, please feel free to put that in the envelope. And we have our lovely community members, Jerry and Uncle Steve Tamayo, will be walking the basket down and as a time to give. And then at the end, they'll meet me here and they'll offer a prayer on behalf of their couple and the community and everything that was given. And although money is very straightforward as an object to give, there's actually many ways you can give back to the community. And there's a lot of programs and activities and opportunities that I'd like to tell you about through a couple of announcements that we have today. So the first one is a new session that will be held on August 20th through 23rd, and it's called Divine Principle and Health. This is a topic I haven't heard about, right? Incorporating those two core principles. And it's going to be run by Mr. Ken Hybara. He's going to be actually visiting our community and sharing this message to talk about health and divine principle, incorporating those two topics. And he's also going to be sharing about Ilhwa's ginseng and the power that that specific product has. So if you'd like to learn a little bit more about that, he'll be speaking at Sunday at 1 p.m. and also at 7 p.m. If your schedule prefers that time, on Monday and on Tuesday. So three different sessions, one on Sunday, one on Monday, and one on Tuesday. And please talk to Hisako Geshwind if you have any questions or, you know, any feedback around that. So this is an upcoming new session for all of our community members and any guests who'd like to join as well. Additionally, we have a program called The Word of God by Reverend Ignace Watente, and he has really volunteered and come up to speak in French and in English to offer this service to our community members on the first and third Sundays from 9 to 10 a.m. before our normal church service. And then also he's leading a divine principle study the second and the fourth Sundays from 9 to 10 a.m. right here in the French Chapel. So, you know, very inspired brother here. And if you'd like to join and also, you know, feel his energy and let him give back to you and the community, please come out and join us for these upcoming sessions. These are the dates outlining the Divine Principle workshops in Las Vegas. And if you have any questions or need some support about this, please talk to the pastors here if you're interested in attending. It's always great to see how consistent these services are, and everybody who I've talked to who've had a chance to go have always had a very deep and moving experience with such a great group that also comes internationally and nationally. So highly recommend these events in Las Vegas. And like I was mentioning before, there's many ways to give back to the community. There's many ways that you might be asking in my head, I have some time, or I have this gift, or I have this talent. This is where you have the chance to plug in. There's Wednesday beautification, video camera person, articles for website and national news, greeters, obviously cafe and Sunday school. There's so many opportunities where you can really put your love into action. And just like Pastor Mike said, you know, connect to God and his vision and hope and experiences that he has in store for you. So if you're interested in any of these areas, please talk to Pastor Mike for further details or questions and to work with your schedule. And then we want to say a special thank you for our upcoming people who will be cooking and also volunteering and ushering and also cleaning next week. So this is the schedule for next week. And that's the last announcement. And I'd like to kind of close it out with a round of applause for everybody who gives back to the community to make these programs such a success. And I'd like you to all rise so that we can close out together and have our final song by the band. Thank you.